So here we are on the Hapuku River, which is located about 5 to 10 kilometres north of Kaikoura, and it drains the seaward Kaikoura range out to the Pacific Ocean. We're here on the river to study it because it's responding to all of the landsliding that was created in 2016 when this landscape was shaken by the magnitude 7.8 Kaikoura earthquake, resulting in landslides on all of the hill slopes in the seaward Kaikouras. In the years after the earthquake, the sediment that was produced by those landslides is making its way into the river systems. The river becomes choked with sediment. We know from other earthquakes in other mountainous regions globally that that sediment entering the river system can be a source of prolonged hazard for infrastructure such as the road and the railway downstream for years to even decades after the initial earthquake. And so we're here to study in fine detail for the first time how river systems behave when they're impacted in this way. So one of the really unique ways that we're studying how these rivers are responding to the earthquake is using airborne LIDAR. And so LIDAR provides us with a really accurate measurement of the topography. And if we do that at multiple times over years, then we can actually measure in a very quantitative way how it has changed. Looking at this imagery, we can see that the riverbed has built up or aggraded more than 30 meters just downstream of the dam. And then in the years following that aggradation or that buildup, it's cut back down into that material and started to evacuate it downstream. So one of the things that we're really interested in is understanding how the grain size of the material in the riverbed is changing. And we do that using a drone that flies low-level images of the bed of the river that we can put together in a process called structure for motion to produce very fine scale three-dimensional maps of the riverbed.
So yeah, once the drone takes off, it's just following a pre-programmed flight path, and it's just taking photos at equal intervals up and down the river channel, so we get a whole very detailed view of the active channel of the river. And we can duplicate this path, so every time we come back we're taking a photo of the exact same area and taking photos in the exact same place, so that we can compare every survey that we're doing it about every 3 months, so we can see the changes over time. Yes. So this whole area is the polygon of the flight path that we pre-programmed for the drone to fly. The black bits here where you can see is the photos that it's taken so far, and the white bits are what it's still got to do. This here is where the drone is at the moment, so you can watch it as it moves along and it fills in taking the photos as it goes. Up here in this corner we can actually see what it's looking at. It's low drone battery, it's warning us up here, it's telling us what the percentage actually is, so it's at 28%. So yeah, quite soon it will pause the survey and it will come back to the starting point so we can change the batteries out.
So this camera is a time-lapse camera, and it's basically taking an image of how much water is in the river every 10 minutes, 24 hours a day, day in, day out. So what we're doing right now is just doing a maintenance check to make sure that the camera's working. We're checking the battery, we're downloading the data, we're making sure that it's hunky-dory. So this camera is basically measuring the amount of flow in the river. And we're interested in that because it's the amount of flow in the river that controls how long it takes the landslide-derived sediment to work its way through the river system. So in a similar way to the drone work that we were doing to measure grain size, the camera is capturing another piece of the puzzle in terms of how this river is behaving. So we've moved further up the river. It's building up sediment. The pattern of the river itself has changed. It's gone from a largely entrenched channel, one channel, to multiple branching or braiding channels. And that's an indication of high sediment load. We've now made our way all the way upstream and we're at the mouth of the gorge. And what you can see here is the maximum aggradation surface, or the height that the riverbed has built up to. And what we can see actually is that since then, at this location, the river has actually cut back down. This is a very dynamic or living river system. So, what is the ultimate purpose of the work that we're doing here? The response of these river systems to the sediment pulse produced by the Kaikoura earthquake provides an excellent natural experiment, because by making the detailed measurements that we've talked through today, we can actually calibrate computer simulations of how these rivers behave. And if we can simulate these rivers accurately, then we can forecast how they're likely to behave into the future. And this is really important because it allows us to understand not just what will happen in these rivers after the Kaikoura earthquake, but also what's likely to happen in other systems that experience large earthquakes. And for New Zealand, a really important example of this is a magnitude 8 earthquake on the Alpine Fault, and is likely to generate widespread landsliding along up to 400 kilometre swath of the Southern Alps. We don't know how significant that hazard will be and how long after the earthquake it will persist. And knowing that is really important if we're to plan and develop resilient communities for when that inevitable event occurs.